So, allen einen guten Morgen. Ah, no, sorry. No German, right? Okay, cool. So, hey everyone, welcome to Xamarin Expert Day without S. Just today. I really want to thank the organizer for letting me crash the party. I literally got a tweet from someone saying, "Hey, there is this event in Köln. Are you going? You? Thank you." And then I wrote to Glenn, who is an old friend, and then I said, "Hey, I see you're having something. Can I come?" And then he said, "Yeah, let's give you some time to speak, even." So I was really happy. And so I'm going to talk to you about Azure Functions, also a few other exciting things around Azure. You might know that I joined Microsoft in August, and so now I'm a, what they call a cloud developer advocate, which means that I'm my job literally is to go around the globe and talk about Azure, which is really a cool job. And so I'm very new in Azure, and they really wanted people who kind of have no clue about Azure. Throw us in the cold water. That's Scott Guthrie approach, right? They take you, put you in the cold water. And then you kind of learn to swim, and then you find bugs in the process, and then you write to the PMs and say, "Why doesn't it work?" And then they're like, "Oh, yeah, because we didn't think of it this way, you know?" And so I'm really spending quite a lot of time right now in trying new things. And so I really started with Azure Functions, first of all, because it's new. Second of all, because it's really exciting. It's so-called serverless computing. It's like a very trendy area at the moment. You might have seen that. Amazon also has something in that regard. Google is also doing stuff in that field. And also linked to that, then you have also other exciting topics like Azure Tables, which we are going to use in the demo, or Cosmos DB, which is a distributed database. And we'll talk a little bit more about that. Before we go on, I want to show you a quick video. This is what they call the Azure Manifesto, and it's very American, so you might feel very motivated at the end. But anyway, I think
we
it's
are
nice.
living in an age of breathtaking transformation, where cloud technology is at the core of how the world will do business.
The cloud is unlocking the power and freedom to achieve success, however you define it.
As lifelong allies in business transformation, we know that one thing remains true: the change agents who pursue this opportunity will be challenged
by complexity, resistance, and uncertainty.
And now that technology-driven transformation is inevitable, we have an opportunity and a responsibility to acknowledge this challenge. On the journey to the cloud, Azure is both accomplice and shield.
We are the Cloud Guide, a unique pairing of enterprise grit and innovation in service of human achievement.
And because trust is the currency of progress,
we build inclusive, responsible, secure technology.
Committed to the principles of community, we embrace open source with the free exchange of ideas and creativity.
We rail against technology elitism and the exclusion born of the cloud-only mindset.
We believe that the success made possible by the cloud must be accessible to every business and every organization, small and large, old and new.
Azure. Azure.
Azure. Cloud for all.
And the new Azure logo, I don't know if you saw it, but it was just unveiled recently at Ignite. So this is the Azure Manifesto, and I think you saw that what's really important here is things like open source, for example, but also being flexible. That means we don't want to put everybody in the cloud. We are totally aware that there are cases where it doesn't work. And I think we have some really good tools to enable this mix of technology. So go to the cloud where it makes sense. This is a list of the cloud developer advocates. You might see some a few names that you know already. Interestingly, quite a few of those people come from a totally non-Microsoft background. So some of them come from Google, some of them from Docker, from Node.js, from other areas. And in fact, I'm probably one of those with the most Microsoft background in the team, so those make for very interesting discussions. Here on the side here, you have all the Twitter information, so feel free to follow us. Feel free to come and see some presentations when we are around. We are always happy to meet people. So enough slides. I want to show you code. So what we are going to do now is build a small Azure function. And we are going to do that, first of all, in the Azure portal. So the Azure portal is where you have all your resources. Okay, if I go to dashboard, I can see quite a lot of resources that I have here. And now we are going to build a new function, and you can really do that directly from the web browser if you want. Okay, you can also do that in Visual Studio. I'll show you that in a second. But if you want to go here in the web browser, you say new, then you can select what kind of resource you want to do. Here I'm going to select function application. I'm going to enter a name. The name has to be unique. Function sample, for example. Then I select the subscription. So the subscription is where you're going to be billed. Okay. Now if you don't have a subscription, you can actually select a free Azure account. It's going to give you some credit, $200 credit. And also check it out, there are quite a few services which are free forever. Okay. You have to enter a credit card when you register. This is purely for identification because we want to make sure that we don't have people making bad things like sending spam to everybody. We hate spam, right? So this is really purely the goal of this verification, but you're not going to be billed until you say so, all right? So you can check it out, you can try. With 200 bucks, you're good to go for at least a few months if you are a little bit conservative with resources, so that allows you to try things out. In that case, I'm going to select an existing resource group. Resource group is just a grouping of all your Azure resources for a specific application, and then I can select a hosting plan, probably zoom a little bit. Hosting plan is going to tell me how I am going to be billed. And so here I select a consumption plan. That's great for startups. If you don't know how many users you're going to have, it's basically pay as you go, which means that if you have a lot of people hitting your service, you're going to be billed a little bit more. If you don't have many people, or in the beginning nobody else, then you're not going to be billed at all, which is kind of a good choice. Now, of course, this makes it a little bit difficult to plan a budget, all right? So if your firm is growing up and having more success, then maybe you want to switch to app service plan, and in that case, you will know much better how you're going to be billed. Location, we have quite a lot of data centers. I'm going to select Western Europe. By the way, we are in Germany. There is a specificity in Germany, which is interesting. In Germany, you need to make sure that the data is accessible only by German people, not by US people, all right? Otherwise, people don't buy your service. And so here in Germany, for example, you have a data center which is made by Microsoft, but Microsoft employees don't have the rights to go into, which is really cool, I think. So it is managed. Well, at least not US employees. I guess maybe I'm neutral, I'm Swiss, they would let me in, maybe. But anywho, really it's managed by a German firm. So we have those specificities if you're in a country which has some issues with data. You don't want the NSA to send an order to give data, then you have these kind of solutions. Okay, then I'm going to select an existing storage account. And I can also switch on Application Insight, which is going to give me a lot of analytics about who is calling my service. Okay, then you can sort, you can do queries, you can do custom events, you can do quite a lot of things. And then at this point, I could click on Create. I'm not going to do that because it takes a couple of minutes to be ready. So I'm instead going to cheat. I already prepared one. And if I go in my functions application, you see that I already have a sample here. And so now I can go and add an actual function. So how do we do that? We click on plus, and then I'm going to select a custom function. And here I have a number of options. So I can select an HTTP trigger, which means that the function is going to be executed whenever there is an HTTP request. It can be a get, a post, a delete, whatever, but it's like the basis for a REST API if you want. Then I have, for example, time trigger, which means that the function is going to be executed on a schedule. All right, I have a queue trigger. That's great when you have multiple Azure services which need to communicate together. You send a message to a queue. When the message reaches the end of the queue, then it is executed, and then the function is triggered. You have a blob trigger, which means that if you upload a blob, right, like it can be any file really, like video, images, it's great for media, for example, the function is triggered, and then it's going to do things like, for example, I don't know, tagging a picture or extracting the geolocation information, these kind of things. And then you have quite a lot of other things, right? There is even somewhere a GitHub trigger, which means that your function can be executed every time you commit something to GitHub, and then you run, for example, continuous integration, these kind of things. So quite a lot of things. Here in that case, I'm going to select an HTTP trigger, just create it. And now you will see that I already have some code available in the web browser. And here we go. And so in that case, what it's going to do, it's going to take the name. It's a little bit small, but I'm just explaining to you, taking the name from the query string, okay, of the URL. And then after that, it's going to say hello plus name. And here I can really go and modify that code. For example, I can say hello from Köln, and then the name, okay? Then at this point, I can save the function. And now I want to run it. So how do I do that? Well, here, there is get function URL. So I can take this URL, copy that. Let's use the function here. Paste that into a web browser. Of course, I need to add a name. This is a query string. So I say at name equals, I don't know, what's your name? Who is looking at me? What's your name?
Roger.
Roger. I saw you yesterday. I should know that, right? Here we go. And now we have hello from Köln, Roger. So it works. So here we did a function. It's like a unit of computation. And did you notice we didn't have to bother about setting up a server, right? That's why we call that serverless computing. Well, I'm going to tell you a big secret. Don't repeat that. There is actually a server. It's just that you don't have to worry about it, okay? Yeah, I know. Don't tweet that, okay? Cool, so that's the basics. Now, of course, the function are pretty advanced already. You can do quite a lot of things here. You can go and test with different parameters, but of course, at some point, you probably want something a little bit more elaborate, and so this is when we typically switch to Visual Studio. Now, in Visual Studio, I can also create functions, and you would do that by going to File, New Project. Now, I did have, this is 2017, I installed the Azure workload. So when you have the installer, there is a new installer for Visual Studio 2017. Then you have different workloads. For example, desktop programming, cross-platform programming for us Xamarin people. There is also an Azure workload. So you select that, and then if you go to cloud, you will see Azure functions, and so you can create your application. Then after that, you want to add an actual function with a trigger. So you do add new item. And again, here on top, you have Azure function, all right? And then if I click here, then I will see all the triggers that I had before, HTTP trigger, timer trigger, etc. Here I created a timer trigger. So this is the code. I have my function, I have the name, and then I have here a timer trigger. And this weird expression here, this is called a cron expression. It's like a schedule. So what it says every time that the second is zero, and the minute is zero, so really on top of the hour, every hour, okay, every 1 hour, on any day, any month, any year, please run the function. So it's going to run the function every 1 hour, okay? Now, of course, we need to say, that's not what I wanted to do, we need to say what the function is going to do. So let's work. First of all, I'm going to create a few constants. And of course, one important constant is a connection string. I'm going to do work with data. Now, in that simple demo, I'm going to use Azure Tables. It's like the easiest way to store data on Azure at the moment. Of course, it's also a little bit simple. So, for example, there is no automatic replication of data around the globe. If you want that, you can go with Cosmos DB, a little bit more complex to set up. But Cosmos DB is going to allow you to select. For example, I have a lot of users in Australia. I can click on Australia, and then automatically my data is going to be synchronized in Europe, Western Europe, and in Australia. And if I have a lot of users in the US, I can click on US, and then it's going to replicate. All right? You don't have to worry about the synchronization. It's all taken care of. Here in that case, I want to use Azure Table. So I need a connection string to connect to the database. To do that, I go in the Azure Storage Explorer, which is a very good tool if you want to do these kind of things. And here you see I have my account. Okay, this is a storage account that I connected to. I have my tables. Here I could see also the blobs if I wanted to, file share, the queues. In that case, the table. And then I have an existing table called coins. That's the one I'm going to use. Now, the fact that it's existing is irrelevant to my code because I have a way to create it on the fly. In that case, I want the connection string. So I click on the storage account. I go down to the properties, and here I have the connection string. I'm going to copy that, go into my code, and I can paste it. There are multiple ways to do that. It's just one way. Now the table name, I want to save what I'm going to save to this table named coins. to demonstrate, and so that it's a little bit clearer, because I have this function already published, so it is actually running. Okay, if I go to the coins table, you see that I have quite a lot of values already. Taking a moment to load, I have already a lot of values. Those are, by the way, the value of Bitcoin. So I save the value of Bitcoin every hour. Like this, I can do a little bit of analytics on that, which is kind of interesting because I want to get rich at some point. I still didn't. But with my new analytics, I will probably. So I want to avoid messing with that table. And so here, I'm just for the demo, I'm going to create a new table called Coins2, right? Very original. Then I have this URL, which has nothing to do with Azure. This is actually a service which gives me some JSON, and it's returning me the value of Bitcoin. So every time I call this service, I get the value of Bitcoin in different currencies. Now, very interestingly, this service seems to be down right now. And yet my demo is working. So that's what I was saying before. I don't understand, you know, when you have something which is working and you don't know why, it's like the worst situation possible. It's worse than if it's not working and you don't know why, because at least you can debug. Here, I'm not sure how to debug something which is working, right? But anywho, here you would have some very nice JSON if the service was available. And anyway, I'm going to connect to that. And so let's do this code. I'm going to create a cloud storage account based on the connection string. I'm going to get a table client. Here at this point, I could get a queue client, a cloud, a blob client if I wanted to. I'm going to get a reference to the table. Remember, it's named coins2. I'm going to create it if it doesn't exist already. So you see that from my code, I don't have to worry about checking if the table works or whatever. I'm just creating it if it doesn't exist. Okay. Then I'm going to do something which has nothing to do with Azure, but from my function, I'm going to do an HTTP client, get the JSON, and start parsing it, all right? Now the parsing, I don't go into the detail. This is always the most boring part of every presentation, but basically I have a price dictionary, and the price is currency value, currency value, currency value. Here in that case, I take US dollar, and then I'm going to create the entity. Now the entity is something that you need. It needs to derive from table entity to save to a table. But the cool thing with Azure Tables and also Cosmos DB, it's what we call schema-less, which means that your tables don't have a schema. They are totally free. You can create an object on the fly, store it into your table, and then it will automatically create the columns for you, okay? It is so flexible that it can be a little bit dangerous. I can very well have one column with mixed types, with a string and a boolean. That happened to me last week, and I wrote a blog about it, because suddenly I was getting the value, I was expecting a boolean, and it was always false, because it was actually a string, and string, when you know, if it's not the string true, it converts to false. So basically, kind of a bug, the people in Azure tell me, no, it's not a bug, it's actually because it's schema-less, and I'm like, yeah, sure, but, you know. So anyway, be careful with that. But on the other hand, super flexible, right? You can just create an object on the fly, derive from table entity, save it, and boom, you're done. Here in that case, I'm going to save the symbol, BTC for Bitcoin. I could have ETH for Ethereum, for example, the time of reading, and the price in US dollar. Then I'm going to insert that value into the table. And it is that easy, okay? I have another function, and then I'll show you how you can debug that. This other function is going to be an HTTP trigger. So this time I'm going to react to a GET. Okay, I could also define a route. In that case, I'm just going to use a simple GET. I don't even have parameters. I'm going to get the account just like before, get the table just like before. I'm going to create a query. And then with this query, you can do some link queue. You can say where value equals blah, 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 where symbol equals BTC, etc. Going to get, here is my query, by the way. I'm going to skip a few, blah, blah, blah. And basically what I do, I take the 10 last values here. And based on those values, I have here this calculus linear regression. So I'm doing a little bit of analytics. I'm checking the trend. Is it going up, flat, or down? Okay. And then eventually I'm going to create an object with a current value and the trend. So one means it's going up, zero is flat, and minus one means it's going down. And then I return the response. You see that I'm sending the object directly, but I say this should be application JSON, and that's doing that for me. It's already going to parse to JSON automatically, to serialized to JSON automatically. All right, now we want to test that. So, of course, I could test, like we all do, I could go to my production server, deploy, and test. That's what we do, right? But here I want to be a little bit more clever than that. So when I install the cloud, the Azure workload, I also installed the function's runtime on my machine. It is locally saved on the machine. That's exactly the same runtime which is running on Azure. It's not a simulator, okay? And so I can actually start it. So what I'm going to do, I'm going to put a breakpoint here. Going to put a breakpoint here in my two functions. Then I'm going to click here to start the debugging. It's going to spin up a console with everything I need to debug. And then it's going to jump in my code. And so I can do my debugging directly on Visual Studio without having to worry. All right. Here I'm jumping into my trigger, my timer trigger, okay? And then I can run. So I say, okay, let's go and get the table. All right, I have a table. Let's go and get the JSON. Now that's the part. Oh, see here it fails. Interesting. So when I try, okay, so they probably have a CDN somewhere. Anyway, so here it's going to fail because the server is down. That's what you saw before, okay? From my Azure, from the publish function, it's actually working. So I think they have something in the US which is working, but they have something here which is not working. So anyway, here it's failing. No problem. At least you know that something's not working. If I was continuing the code, you would see that I would get the price, I would create the entity, execute, and then it would save, okay? Now I want to try the other one. So to try the other one, what I will do is that I will go back to my coins table. I will remove this, I will run, because I want to show you how to test the HTTP trigger. You can also test the HTTP trigger locally, all right? So I'm starting that, and you see down there, I have the information I need. It says here, it gives me a local URL. I'm going to copy that. And then I'm going to go into my web browser, paste it here, and now I'm jumping into my code, okay? So now I can run the code. Let's go and take the table. Let's do a query. How many do I have? I have 835 values. Here I'm not super efficient because I actually only need 10, so I could take only 10 directly in the query, but whatever, I'm going to select here, calculate the trend, and so now I see the current value is $4,340 and the trend is going up. So it's not a good time to buy, all right? And then I can return the response. And if I go to my web browser, you see that I have the response directly expressed in JSON, which is what I need. All right, so that's really cool. So now I can actually go ahead and build an application. So here I have the code. This code is on GitHub, so you can have access to it. I have my function here.
Rob, small question.
Go ahead.
If you deploy that function.
Oh, I need to show you how to deploy. It's a good point. Yes, so there are a lot of things that you can get. So first of all, you can log anything using this logger here, this TraceWriter logger. Now that's going to log directly to the web portal. So after that, you can go to your Azure portal and see the log trace. That's the first thing. Then after that, the other thing you can do, you can enable Application Insight because this is nothing else than an application service. So it's like a website if you want. If you enable Application Insight, then you get all your crashes information for free. So you get the stack trace, etc. When I say for free, it's up to a certain amount. I think it's 1.5 gigabyte per month or something like that. So if you go higher than that, if you have a service which is really popular, at some point you might have to pay for that. But when you get started, you get everything for free, all right? So you can get crashes and everything. You can also get custom events. So using Application Insight, the API, you can just log your custom events, all right? Cool. So now at this point, if I wanted to publish, here we go. I would go here, click on the function, click on publish, and then you have everything you need here. I'm not going into the details here. You can find it out by yourself, but basically click on publish and then it goes to the cloud. All right. Cool, so I build a client for that. And of course, I build the client using Xamarin. So I have an Android client, I have a UWP client, I have an iOS client coming up, but I still didn't get my Mac from Microsoft. So I'm kind of in between two chairs right now. But basically, it is a very, very simple client. It is using the same data than the function. In that case, it's a portable class library, but I could very well use .NET Standard if I wanted, okay? And this is allowing me to have all my service, things like the coin trend, for example, which is the entity that I'm saving. Now in that case, let's take a look at the service. Service is super easy. It's going to create an HTTP client, get the JSON from my function URL, which is up here. I showed you before, you can get it from the portal corner top right. And then after that, I deserialize and I return the trend. After that, in my main view model, what I'm going to do, this is using MVVM Lite, no surprise to anybody. I'm going to get the trend here. I'm going to create a few properties, so the current coin values, and I have a few booleans here saying, is it going up, flat, or down? And then after that, in my Android code, I'm going to just go ahead, create a few bindings here. All right, those are MVVM Lite bindings. And then it allows me to use images. If I go and show you the running code on the Android emulator, here we go, I'm going to refresh. And then I should get the value and I should get the trend. Here we go, 4,340 like we saw before, and the trend is going up. And I also have the Windows version of that. Here we go, it works, all right? And of course, in iOS, it would work exactly the same. So it is a very convenient way to build an application, to build an API. And plus, the fact that those functions are kind of self-contained, it kind of forces you, and that's what I was discussing before, it kind of forces you to think in terms of architecture, to think of interfaces, to think of, you know, small self-contained function code. You don't want to have like thousands of lines in your function, so you kind of have to think of smaller objects. So it's actually a good practice, all right? Okay, now, let's say that I wanted to add notifications here. So you probably all have heard of Notification Hub on Azure. You probably all heard of Xamarin Test Cloud. You probably all heard of Hockey App for analytics. Well, right now it was kind of a little bit of a mess, right? You have a lot of services, they are not necessarily from the same provider, and they are not necessarily connected, and you don't really know where to find the documentation. Well, I have a good news, it's all coming down under one roof, and this roof is called the Azure Mobile Center. Mobile Center, the URL is mobile.azure.com, all right? This is a new area where you can set up your analytics, your crash reporting, your push notifications, and more for your application, as well as the testing, the test cloud, etc. So the way that it will work is that you will go and create a new application. And here in this application, you have to say, do you want iOS with Objective-C? You can do that if you want, or Swift, React Native or Xamarin, Android with Java, React Native or Xamarin, or Windows with UWP. Then you can create your application, all right? Once you create your application, here I have an Android application, you have a little bit of documentation here, and here you have a few things you can do. You can set a build. So build here, I can say, okay, my code is going to live in GitHub, for example. Every time you commit to a given branch, it's going to automatically trigger continuous integration, and then you get the build, all right? So you don't have to set that yourself. It's given to you here. By the way, to go into there, you don't even need an Azure account here. A GitHub account is sufficient for the Mobile Center. So it's really developer-friendly, okay? You can test, so that is basically running on Xamarin Test Cloud. So here you can select a set of devices, just like you did in Test Cloud before, and then you can run your thing here. You can distribute your code to beta testers directly from here, so you can select a few testers, and then when you have a new build that you want to publish as a beta, you push to them, all right? You can have some analytics, so you have crashes and analytics, custom events. And then you have push notification, which you can do from here. In that case, this is an Android application, so it tells me how to set up the Google, the Firebase cloud messaging, all right? If you were doing Apple, you would set the Apple messaging system. If you do Windows, you would set the Windows notification system. Everything is described, and then you can push your notifications directly from here. There is also an API, so you can also do some REST calls to that. This is still in preview, so it's still a little bit rough around the corners, but in a few weeks it's going to be released, and then you can start using it. So I encourage you looking into that. Cool thing is that it's one roof for all the services that before were a little bit scattered, And also the documentation is much more current now because all that has been actually maintained by the people on my team. All right? So there is a free tier which is very generous. After a while, you probably have to pay something, but really the free tier is quite generous. Yeah, so you can, I mean, if you have like for tests, for startup, for things like that, it's free to use, absolutely. Okay?
Question.
Yep.
Given all this nice to have wizards, right?
Yep.
And it has some sort of step of building to it, but after this is done, what, in your view, what additional thing one has to do in order to complete the whole step of?
In here?
Yes.
So, I can't go too deep into the details because of time, but we can talk later if you want. Basically, here you have your DevOps, which means that basically it's going to run. I'm not super familiar with that part. You know what? Let's talk later. Okay, we'll explore a little bit. You just come and join me. All right?
If you want, DevOps.
Oh yeah.
It's written a book about it. really, he has some copies along, so you can talk to him also.
Good.
But the whole process is in there.
And I'm cool. Also available for the 1 hour speaker session you have.
Mm-hmm.
Thanks very much. Just one question to the Azure function.
Yeah.
Is it possible to automate tests for this?
Yes, so actually what you can do, because this is a totally standard .NET application with, basically it's an app service, so it's like, if you want, it uses exactly the same libraries as an ASP.NET MVC application, for example. So you can actually split your code after that. If your code grows a bit, you can split it in objects or whatever. What I do is that typically this code in my function, I'm wrong here, but if I go to my function, basically I would split the code and then I would write unit tests, and then you can run your unit tests and that would work, okay? Well, the function is just a URL, so I mean, if it's a getter, right, so you can actually do that as well, yeah.
Okay.
So you can just write an automatic test, like if you want to check that everything's working, like do regression tests or things like that, that would work, yeah. Okay? Cool. All right, so I need to finish because I'm at the end of my time. Just want to show you that I do have quite a lot of resources to get you started. And so that would be here. GitHub repository, okay, the code that I showed you is everything is in GitHub. This is a living repo, so I'm actually in the process of adding notifications using the mobile center, so you can check it out if you want. There is some introduction to Azure Functions, including two quick start, one for the portal, so you can create your function directly in the web browser like we did before, one for Visual Studio, Azure Storage Explorer, that's the tool I was using to check my tables. It's like a must if you do anything with data in Azure. The free Azure account, so if you click here, you will get your free account to try things out. Mobile Center and the documentation, all right? This is, like I said, in preview right now. Getting started with Cosmos DB. I told you a little bit about Cosmos DB. You can replicate your data automatically. And finally, the Cloud Developer Advocates. Check it out. We have a website, and we have also a Twitter and everything. All right, I want to thank you very much for your attention. I hope it was helpful for you. You can use that to create your next mobile application, maybe. I would be really happy to see the work you do. Want to wish you a very, very good conference today, and maybe I will talk to some of you a little bit later. Have a great day. Thank you.